It's interesting to listen to the debate today and see the great divide that exists over the issue of responsibility for pensions. What has driven the two sides, the two parties, into such strident positions on an issue of pensions for public sector workers? And it's a fascinating question. And being a history teacher, maybe a short history of pensions might help us to understand a few main elements. Pensions are not really new. In fact, pensions for military personnel date back to Roman times, with the use of pensions to grant legionnaires post-service income, and I stress income. Many other societies have paid our sailors and soldiers, including the Colonial Army and Navy during the Revolutionary War. Mr. Speaker, in more recent times, public sector pensions were begun in the late 19th century, and private sector pensions in the early 20th century. Private sector pensions peaked in the United States at about 48% of workers in 1980 and have been dropping ever since. Public sector pensions have remained fairly constant over the last 50 years. In all cases, these were defined benefit pensions until the early 1990s, when the concept of defined contributions began with the advent of 401k plans. And these plans became more popular as companies in the private sector trying to pass more responsibility of pension liability to employees. With the economic collapse of 2008, the move to 401k defined contribution plans was greatly accelerated as both the private sector and, in some cases, states and local municipalities strained by reduced revenue considered 401k plans. Now, please remember that the 401k plans were originally developed in 1978 and approved by the federal government. They were introduced to supplement defined benefit pension plans, not to replace them. Mr. Speaker, it's important to remember this history because Senate Bill 1 is being presented to us as a bill to save us from the destruction of our current pension plans. But in reality, this is not the case. This is far more ideological. We do not have a benefit problem. We have a debt problem. The unfunded liability comes from the issue of past debt. And that debt accumulated in large part because of poor market performance during the years of the economic collapse and the lack of the state contributions. And to fix the issue of that past debt, we're mortgaging the retirement security of thousands of employees across the state. This bill, Senate Bill 1, does nothing to eliminate that debt. That debt will still be there. The workers of Pennsylvania, the public sector workers of Pennsylvania, have paid into the system every week, every month, every year. They have made their contributions, the state has not, in all cases. What we have in Senate Bill 1 is an attempt to permanently reduce the state's responsibility for the pensions of public employees, to take away that liability on the state. We hear we can no longer afford the cost of these pensions, and yet these pensions average only $25,000. And now are to be replaced under this measure by a plan that would see future retirees receive up to 70% less on average, or about $7,500. That, Mr. Speaker, would be about $625 per month after 30 years of service, or even if you want to calculate it out, roughly $150 per week. The supposed savings that the bill creates are estimated to be about $10 billion over 30, 35, or 38 years, depending upon which system we're looking at. And these could be achieved in other ways. For instance, an increase in the personal income tax of 1/6 of 1%. Let me repeat, 1/6 of 1% would raise the same amount of money to to keep the system fully funded as to where we are, spread out over those 38 years. 1/6 of 1%. Think about that. So picture 38 years from now, when people retire under this new system with that 70% reduced pension benefit, 70% less than everybody in this chamber will receive. Picture the loss of the $17 billion to the Pennsylvania economy that happens each year. $17 billion in loss that is pumped into that system of our economy in Pennsylvania. How do we make up that loss, Mr. Speaker? Mr. Speaker, as we've heard, Senate Bill 1 was fast-tracked and rammed through the Senate and also through the House State Government Committee, giving members of the committee inadequate time to ask questions, analyze, and debate key changes. Pension changes this dramatic must be fully vetted and debated and understood so the entire General Assembly, along with the people of Pennsylvania, understand the financial consequences that this bill has for our state and its employees. Quite simply, we are not being given that chance. And I would say, Mr. Speaker, that like health care, all people deserve to have good pensions in their golden years, when they can no longer work productively, when age takes over and makes it so that they can't be productive. That is why we've had them for over 100 years. And as you've heard, who does it affect most? Women. Women, more vulnerable than others, but the largest bulk of our percentage of people who are teachers and in those other fields that we've heard about that have now been away from those fields that have been carved out. This bill is bad for our workers. Frankly, it's bad for state government, and it's bad for Pennsylvania. The only people who gain from this bill, this bad bill, are the investment brokers and investment bankers who stand to gain from the fees paid by public workers handling their 401k investments. Workers who have faithfully contributed into the pension fund lose, families lose, pensioners lose, and Pennsylvania's economy loses. Billions lost for workers, billions gained by investment managers. There's something very wrong with this picture. For these reasons and more, Mr. Speaker, I implore my fellow legislators to vote no on Senate Bill 1, protect the retirement security of Pennsylvanians, and try to find a way to make sure that all Pennsylvanians have a secure and productive retirement. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.